It's really nice to see that everybody has made it, especially during the disordered environment that was the Brazilian election yesterday. But we're going to hear lots about disorder, but in a very different context. We're going to be hear about disorder in the context of the complex and fascinating phases that appear when you have these disordered elastic materials. And it's a real pleasure to have all these lecturers that are really nice to talk to us. I'd like to start by thanking them for coming and thanking you for coming to this school. And without further delays, I'm going to let Professor Jim Sethna start to give the first lecture in our school. And he's going to talk about scaling functions in disordered elastic materials. Thank you.
Welcome. I'm pleased to be the opening lecturer here. I was a little nervous about it, but I think I figured out a way of doing it nicely. I wanted to thank Danilo Liarte, Carolyn Brito, and Itai Cohen. Itai isn't here yet, but he'll be here in midweek sometime, for arranging this this school. We've had a great fun creating a set of lectures that I think will entertain you in a little bit. I'm going to be talking about scaling functions in disordered elastic materials, and there are going to be two themes. My PhD advisor, P.W. Anderson, the year before I joined his group, he gave some great lectures in Les Ouches School, another school like yours, on ill-condensed matter. And I feel kind of grumpy that I missed it just by 1 year. And there were lots of different lecturers. But he emphasized at the beginning that he was offering, or the school was offering, a new paradigm at the time. This is 1978. You were not born yet. And the new paradigm was, how are disordered materials different from regular systems? And today and tomorrow, I will be talking about that picture. The disordered systems, unlike liquids and gases and crystals, disordered systems have very unusual nonlinear behavior. They have avalanches in particular, and I will be talking quite a bit about, can you see the dot? Never mind. About avalanches and emergent scale invariants. And then he said, the old paradigm is how you can take a disordered system and reduce it to an ordinary system, a system that you're familiar with, make it look the same as a regular solid. And he said that had been the field of the subject before. And he mentioned effective medium theory, and that's going to be the theme of the last half of my lectures. That it turns out in a nuanced way, you can understand a lot about the important material properties that emerge on long length scales in disordered systems using these old techniques. And the first part was done with an enormous number of colleagues, and I will mention their names, I hope, if I remember to, when I get to their slides: Karen Dahman, Chris Myers, Olga Perkovich, Matt Kuntz, Lorian Hayden, Archishman Raju. Anyway, the new material, I should say, is based on the work of our co-organizer, Danilo Liarte, and work that I was not involved with two of our speakers, Xiaoming Mao and Tom Lubinsky, who basically did the calculation of the effective medium theory. And what am I doing up here talking about it? Well, Danilo and I and Steve Thornton up there recognized at some point that the calculation they had done, which was focusing on just the elastic constants, could be turned into a general theory of the materials. If you believe the calculation, you get predictions for everything. Everything linear, everything in the old-fashioned sense. And then with Steve Thornton and Danilo Learte in that order, I'm gonna describe a simplified form of the calculation that we've come up with that allows us to do a little more. And throughout this discussion, these four lectures, I'm going to be focusing the whole framework on what are called universal scaling functions. I'll tell you what universal scaling functions are, I'll derive their form, in case you have not seen them before, and I imagine many of you haven't. And they're a very important tool for this whole subject, and that will be the theme. So, now here's the part of the introduction. Every country has its own style, and this I thought would be a very American way, a North American way, a United States way of introducing my lectures here. This worked a moment ago. It's okay. There's a backup. How do disordered systems agree with glasses, liquids, and crystals, and how do they differ? There's a whole raft of disordered systems, and many of which will be described in the formalism that I've been using. No guarantees that the jamming transition that we'll be talking about is the explanation for glasses, but it's pretty clear it's the explanation for many properties of granular materials, sands and powders, except, of course, that we assume spherical frictionless particles, which isn't exactly realistic except for colloidal suspensions. Colloidal suspensions are well described until they get really dense by frictionless particles. Foams and emulsions, heads of beer, there's a liquid gas, a liquid to solid transition as the bubbles in the beer float upward, collect on the top, and the water between them drains away, and there's a point at which they stop flowing like a liquid. So you can pick up in your hand some beer foam and it won't flow away. And then there's glass, the problem that even Phil Anderson in 1978 spent a lot of time thinking about glass. And it's not just window glass, you know, there are metallic glasses. And then the thing I like the best, but it's hardest to describe, is what in the United States we call hard candy. In England they call them boiled sweets, and I understand in Portuguese they call it doce duro. Anyway, these granular materials and colloidal suspensions and such have a fluid or floppy state. They flow like a liquid or gas when they're dilute, sheared or agitated. So you take a powder and you shake it, and then you can pour it out your container, and it'll pour like a fluid. Beer bubbles, before they get into the foam at the top, melted glass, they're described by a viscosity. You don't, on the other hand, as you approach the point at which they become solid, the motion is not the same as a regular liquid. They're complex, multi-scale, jerky motions. As you pour a colloidal suspension near the jamming transition, they're non-Newtonian fluids. They have viscosities that grow and grow as you get more dense, in particular for glasses. As solids, they have elastic moduli. They have dry suds and glasses, you know, you bang on them and they ring. They have sound waves, they have elastic, they behave like a regular material. But again, if you shear them, they don't have dislocations that flow around. They have complex non-affine deformations, okay? And they have avalanches. They have many metastable states. They're not in their ground states. They're stuck in some weird state. And when you try to shear them, they will hop into a new state. In the process, may just have a few atoms rearrange or a few grains in your granular material, or you could have a large scale flow of lots of particles. And it's that, and so in the first couple of lectures, I will be talking about the complex, multi-scale, avalanche kind of physics. And the last couple of lectures, I will derive a universal scaling function using derivations that we finally worked out the details of a few days before the conference. Stephen, in particular. Okay, avalanches, I like the example of earthquakes. We do not have the final perfect theory of earthquakes. We have the final perfect theory, we believe, for avalanches and magnets and a few other systems, but earthquakes is hard to do experiments on. Earthquakes come in many small earthquakes and only a few large earthquakes. This is the magnitude. This size earthquake, you know, cities turn to rubble. And these earthquakes, even if they happen right underneath you, you don't feel them. They have a bursty behavior. They happen a few days in a year. And the biggest earthquakes are so much bigger than the smaller ones. This power law distribution is going to be a theme. Those are universal power laws. Pardon? These are the earthquakes in 1995, which I've just plotted. You can find them, but nobody ever draws these plots. The histograms are due to Gutenberg and Richter, and this is called the Gutenberg-Richter law. And this is just the distribution of avalanches as a function in logarithmic bins in energy radiated, which I'll call size, and which is normally called the magnitude. People used to, okay. And there are lots of models for these systems. This was an early model just at the point where physicists started crowding into the earthquake field. Per Bach, of course, would wander around saying, you guys are all idiots. This is the way to think about earthquakes. But Carlson, Gene Carlson and Jim Langer built on real earthquake people's models and came up with something that also did develop power laws, but probably is not the perfect theory of real avalanches, of real earthquakes. That was strange. What's going on there? Okay. Good. So, crackling noise. If you take a piece of paper, actually, how many of you have a piece of paper you can spare? Crumple it up and listen. This was an experiment that we did when Karen Dahman was applying for a Harvard Junior Fellowship. Karen Dahman, an amazing student, did an epsilon expansion, which turned out not to be correct, replica symmetry breaking or something, for avalanches in a random field Ising model. And she was going off to Harvard to try to explain to the fellowship committee, which had historians and English professors, why they should give her this fellowship. And I said, we have to do something other than talk about Barkhausen noise and magnets. Let's see if we can come up with something that really crackles in day-to-day life. And we're theorists. So we tried a pencil. I remember all those movies where there's a hurricane in the tree and it's going as the hurricane tears it apart. And we tried a pencil and it went snap and it wasn't very interesting. And then the next thing we tried was paper. We later wrote a paper on paper crumpling, and that turned out to be almost newsworthy, meaning the people at the University of Chicago were crumpling mylar plastic sheets, and we thought that nobody's going to read a paper on mylar plastic sheets. They'll take us. We were taking real paper and crumpling it. And then the news article came out, crackling noise in movie theaters when you unwrap your piece of candy. And they got all the publicity. It's okay. It's nice. Crackling noise in Rice Krispies. Oh, nuts. Can't hear that. Oh, there it is. This is fluid invasion into a porous medium. This was Mark Robbins wrote the same model that we studied, the random field Ising model, to describe this before we did. And he also found fractal behavior and avalanche-like physics. This is not an experiment. We just digitized our model for magnets, and here's Gianfranco Durin came up with this one. Tearing paper has fractal distribution of sizes. not only do you have things of different sizes, but each of the avalanches has interesting fractal structure. Here you see the avalanches in our three-dimensionalizing model. I won't be spending that much time talking about that model, but, oops, sorry. So notice they'll start small, they'll get bigger and bigger, and then blam, the big red one will come, and then it turns out you fill in some of the holes left over. And this, come on, I can do this. Okay, bigger, bigger, bigger. You're approaching a transition. So this is going to be. So this happens a lot. You push it harder and harder, and suddenly it starts flowing. Or in this case, suddenly you get a big jump. This is one kind of criticality, one kind of point where you can get avalanches of all scales. Another thing happens sometimes generically. So random walks have fractal behavior on all scales. And then there's something called self-organized criticality, which often happens in things like earthquakes. You don't have to tune the Earth to get a power law distribution of earthquakes. Earthquakes happen because you're not increasing the force on the earthquake fault. The earthquake fault is being driven at 1 centimeter or 3 centimeters per year. And in the limit where that rate goes to zero, you're at the critical point. You're at the point where it's just barely flowing. And so that's why you get self-similar behavior. There are two things, so now I'm introducing the renormalization group. Some of you have done the renormalization group forever, but some of you haven't, and it's important to at least conceptually understand the roots of the subject. And the first bit is really the fundamental question of why theory can agree with experiment. That if you have a theory for a magnet, it's not correct. It's not got the electrons and the atoms and the nuclei. It's making some approximations. And yet, we claim that it gets certain things perfectly. In the same way that Navier-Stokes equation describes fluids perfectly, even though it pays no attention to the atoms. Okay? And that universality also, in this case, is exciting because it extends to systems that microscopically are completely different from one another. It's not just your theory is different from the experiment, different experiments look the same. So here is the liquid gas critical point. And here's a bunch of fluids. Notice water is not one of them. And all of them, as you approach this special point, stop being a gas or a liquid and smoothly go between them. This is high pressure and high temperature. And if you rescale all of them to the critical temperature and the critical pressure, dividing T by TC and rho by rho C, the gas and the liquids all collapse. Part of this is just because these are all boring molecules that look roughly spherically symmetric, and so it's not a surprise they all behave the same up to an overall scale. But there's a weird thing that puzzled people, which is that it was weirdly flat at the top. This line through there is not your typical parabola that all the sensible theories predicted. It's almost a cubic. And it turns out that magnets, certain magnets, have also the same cubic inflection point at the top. It's not cubic. It turns out later, actually very recently, people have figured out that beta a good way of calculating this critical exponent, and it's 0.326 and not 0.333. So now these two curves do not look the same. But if you tilt this one a little bit, it does look the same. So the idea is two different systems undergoing the same universal critical point will look the same up to a smooth change in coordinates. The way I think about it, who told you that changing the temperature here was nature's way of shaking it more? Maybe changing the pressure or changing the density a little bit is also a way of changing things. So it's a smooth change of coordinates between the coordinates of the magnetization and the temperature to the coordinates of the density and the temperature that maps one of these systems to the other. That will come up again in our normal form theory later. The other key feature that we need to incorporate into our theory is self-similarity. So if you have a random walk and you look at a 2x2 block inside, you know, divide it in half, and you look at that and divide it in half, these statistically look the same. That random walks are scale invariant. When you blow them up, they look the same. If you take our random fieldizing model and you color the avalanches like that animation I had, except I'm now slicing that animation and just showing the final colors, where that big red blob is now a big black blob. That black thing is an avalanche. You can see statistically, these pictures look very similar until you get all the way down to the lattice constant. All right? So this is universality with yourself. It's universality, meaning the thing, the statistics of the behavior on one length scale, if you go to a different length scale, it looks the same. And that's the other thing we need to describe. Okay. Avalanches are also self-similar in time. I didn't show you that in my animation, but each of those avalanches started someplace and then grew and then slowed down and then sped up and then slowed down. And this complicated fractal time series, if you occasionally you can see that the first bit looks like an avalanche all by itself. And the second bit is an avalanche. You can blow each of these sub-avalanches up, and it looks like another sequence of avalanches. It's self-similar. You build little avalanches into big avalanches by having them not quite stop. And then just like you would just like you would coarse grain the atoms in a fluid or take a continuum limit for waves on a string by taking the individual segments and assuming a smooth variation, you can coarse grain things like the Ising model. This is Leo Kadanoff, who started this whole subject in a sense. He said, let's take an Ising model, it's easiest to look at this Ising model. Here's a 3x3 block. There are 9 squares in it. Most of them are white, so I'm going to call it white in the next stage. And that simple procedure, he then made up the new rules for governing the probability of a white square being next to a black square. And that new rule gave him a coarse graining procedure that took the parameters of the Ising model and gave him back new parameters of a coarse grained Ising model. And then Ken Wilson came by. And turn that into a gigantic abstraction. Okay? So the abstraction he had was to think about coarse graining and the coarse graining of the rules in the space of all possible systems. All right? If you have a space of all possible systems, then you have your random field Ising model that forms some kind of line or path in this system, in this space of systems. And over here you might have an experimental magnet. And over here you might have a different class of systems. And remember, this is an infinite dimensional space. Okay. Now, under coarse graining, you take one of these points and it produces another one. And if you keep coarse graining, it follows some path. And in our model, you had to tune to exactly the right field and the right disorder to get the random field Ising model to show self-similar behavior. That is to say, you had to choose a point. This point showed avalanches of all scales. This point showed a few small avalanches and then one great big avalanche. And this point will show lots of small avalanches, but fewer and fewer, bigger and bigger ones. All right? So self-similarity arises if you're at this special point, you flow to a point that falls onto itself after coarse graining. Something that looks the same after coarse graining in the rules is also going to look the same in all the statistics. And then finally, universality. If I have another system that crosses this blue curve, it's going to look the same when it hits that point. You might say, well, what's the probability that you will hit that line in an infinite dimensional space? But I haven't mentioned to you that this is not a line in an infinite dimensional space. It's a giant hypersurface in an infinite dimensional space because all the blue directions flow into S star. All but one direction flows into S star, and that one direction is flowing out. So the one direction that's flowing out we'll call a relevant direction. Actually, there are two relevant directions, but I can't draw that without confusing things. And then all the other directions flow inward. So far, any questions? Yeah. Well, this is meant to be a fairly general system, but the order parameter one of the standard things people talk about is the order parameter. The order parameter has two different kinds of definitions. So in the Ising model, sometimes you say the order parameter is the spin that's either up or down. That's the microscopic description. Some people say the order parameter is the thing that embodies the broken symmetry, which for the Ising model is the magnetization that either points up or down. But in other systems, those two definitions can even be different. I would think the way to think about this is that in this system space, there's a bunch of different models that all kind of flow in the same space. So if I have a liquid and a gas, there's a scalar as a function of position that tells me the density. That if I'm a magnet, an Ising magnet, there's a scalar as a function of position that tells me whether I'm up or down. But if I have a Heisenberg magnet, which can point in any direction, I have a different order parameter. I have a vector everywhere. And that would not be in this universe. That would be a whole separate flow. And it would have a whole separate fixed point. Except that you could have a Heisenberg model that had a new direction that picked out up and down, and then you would have a bigger space. And we'll talk about that in a cross as a crossover. So the microscopic order parameter here is just spins that are either pointing up or down, but that's not the collective order parameter. I'm sure the replica theory people will tell me what they think the order parameter is for the random field-Ising model, but I'm afraid I don't know how to talk about the collective behavior as a field in space-time. I guess it's the magnetization. I guess it would be the local regions that are up and down. But I know glasses, the order parameter is something having to do with long-range order in time, for example. I'm not sure. I answered your question by saying I'm really not sure how to answer it.
When you talk about avalanches in general, in this case, in particular.
I agree. I would like some word like order parameter to tell people what you need to have avalanches, and I don't have an organized answer. Yeah. Okay. So now I'm going... You can read the board if you, but I'm going to do this on the board. First of all, an hour and a half is a long time, and if I keep flashing slides, especially slides with a lot of calculations, you'll all go blind. So I'm going to try writing this on the board. So there are universal power laws. Let's get them out of the way first. You know, Gutenberg-Richter law had a power law. So power laws, and I'm going to give you an example, the avalanche fractal dimension. Which has a universal exponent, which is the fractal dimension. So I have a size, which is like the mass, or the volume, or the energy release, or something like that. It's not the length. That's going to be S. And then there's a length, L. When I say size, it's always going to be something like a volume. And the rule is S over S naught is L over L naught to the d sub f. So if my avalanches are in three dimensions and they're sort of space filling, they don't have holes, then d sub f will be 3. And in the random field-Ising model, d sub f is a little bit smaller than 3 because the big avalanches have little small holes in them, partly because there were little avalanches before the big avalanche came along, and they don't count as part of the big avalanche. Now, how do I get this from the renormalization group? Why is self-similarity and things like that naturally producing power laws? And here, I'm going to do this in a few steps, and I'm going to do it a few more times in the same steps. So this is supposed to make you used to my cheating. How am I cheating? I'm going to write down the renormalization group flows, and then I'm not going to derive this formula from the renormalization group flows. Instead, I'm going to show the renormalization group flows are solved by this formula. As you know from freshman calculus, doing integrals is a pain in the neck. But if you can guess the answer, checking it by differentiating it is easy. That's what I'm going to do. So especially on Friday, where Steve's work is just horrendous if you try to derive it, but checking it is easy. So the renormalization group is going to coarse grain the length. So L prime after one coarse graining step, I'm going to by a small factor one plus delta L. That little L is different from the big L. The big L is something e to the little L. Okay, so just let's not get confused by my notation. So L prime is L divided by 1 plus DL. I'm coarse graining by that factor. Not 3 anymore, but 1 plus DL, which is basically L minus L DL. One over 1 plus DL is about the same as 1 minus DL multiplying, which gives me L minus LDL. And so D big L, D little L, I hate people doing algebra a little too fast for me to follow, so I'm going to give you the intermediate step here. L prime minus L over DL is minus L. Yes, L is getting smaller. I know all my pictures blew up. I'm going the other direction. Okay. So under this, the avalanche size, S, ds by dl, is exactly the same algebra except, sorry, I need first say, is going to be minus A times S. That when I divide the size, when I write the new size, this comes from S prime is S divided by 1 plus ADL. There's no reason that it has to shrink in the same way as the length. In fact, it doesn't even make sense. It has to be different. And now I'm going to check. ds by d capital L, right, is got two formulas. One is to take my definition here and differentiate it. So this is d of s naught L over L naught to the 1 over, to the d sub f, dl. And the other one is to write it as ds by d little l divided by d capital L by d little l, which we know is minus AS divided by minus L is AS over L. So if I can take this formula and turn it into AS over L, I'm done. And we all know how to differentiate that. Yeah?
What is the magnitude of AS over L? The magnitude of the A parameter? What is the magnitude of the A parameter?
A?
In the second line? Yeah.
We're going to get that.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, you know any kind of coarse graining will make S change.
Yeah.
And we're making an assumption that it's changing linearly. As a, it doesn't change with a higher power. And that's going to turn out to be crucial later. Okay?
Thank
tomorrow.
You.
So, and then, okay, so you can work out the algebra. This is S naught over L naught to the d sub f times the derivative of L to the d sub f was d sub f L to the d sub f minus 1, and then there's a d capital L by d little L, which is minus L. And so the L cancels that, okay, I'm skipping steps. Anyway, this turns out to be d sub f S over L. Oh, yes, yes, yes. And then you have to build this so this becomes S naught L over L naught to the D sub F. Times D sub F. Oh, this is capital L, thank you. I should really copy my notes more carefully. I have it right here. I spent a lot of time getting it right. So there's no dl by d little l because I'm taking the derivative with respect to capital L. And so this becomes d sub f minus d sub f over L, which is S naught over L times d sub f. Thank you. Okay, so this is the same as this, with A equal D sub F, which is not a big surprise. So that's the universal critical exponent. These constants A and minus 1 are characteristic linearized flows near the fixed point. Every property has its linear flow near the fixed point, and the combination of those constants give you the universal critical exponents that we learn about in the renormalization group. Questions? I have a second half of this calculation I need to do for the universal scaling function. I'm not going to spend all my time talking about universal critical exponents. I like universal scaling functions. And so this is exactly the same steps, so universal scaling functions. And it's kind of unfortunate that the critical exponents got all the attention for years and years because they're just numbers. You can have whole functions that are universal. okay? And the universal scaling functions for liquid gas transition are kind of boring, but in general, they're pretty cool. So now I'm going to do abstraction, no D sub F and things like that. I'm going to just say X, Y, and Z. So consider Z and X and Y, and you're interested in the function Z of X and Y. Okay? So you might think of magnetization, temperature, and field for the Ising model or something like that. And I'm going to check that the RG predicts the characteristic Z over Z naught is equal to X over X naught to the beta times a universal scaling function of Y over Y naught over X naught to the beta delta. And now I'm going to get rid of the zeros. I'm going to get rid of all those arbitrary constants. You'll just have to remember that they were there. So this is going to be Z of X and Y is X to the beta times universal function of Y over X to the beta delta. Good. And now I'm going to check that. So let's suppose that dx by dl is ax dy by dl is bx, and dz by dl is cx. So it's by cz. I cannot read my own notes. The first step is that I can write this argument as a capital Y is invariant. That is to say, if I'm going to claim that this is a nice power law, then I better not have this guy change that this has to be constant under the flow. Okay, and you check that. D capital Y, D little l is D little y, D little l over X to the beta delta time plus y times X to the times minus b over a I'm going to with beta delta is b over a. So then this becomes a y to the minus b over a times x to the minus b over a minus 1 times dx by dl. We know dy by dl is by, dx by dl is ax, and this a cancels this a, this x cancels that minus one. This B, the minus sign, B with a plus sign, this is just zero. Done. I got one more step to do. I have to show that the derivative of this equation satisfies the renormalization group. So CZ, which is dz by dl, had better equal derivative of the right-hand side with respect to L, d by dl of x to the beta curly z of x y over x to the beta delta. And okay, this thing is beta x to the beta minus one d beta dx d by dl plus d by dx to the beta d by dl of z of y. And nicely, this is zero. I don't have to deal with it. Because y is invariant. So this becomes, this is ax, the x cancels this, b over a b this is cz. Yeah.
What is the physical meaning of the I capital term? What is the physical meaning
of why?
The capital I term. Why?
Which one? The curly z? Or the capital Y.
The invariant scaling combination, Jim.
Yeah, this guy, right?
Yeah. Well, it's a physical meaning.
Their renormalization group flows. Oh, I will have an exercise session, and I'm hoping that on Tuesday you'll get copies of the exercises. And there are three choices, and one of them is to think about the renormalization group flows. And that exercise is supposed to give you a sense for what this means. But in short, I've got x, y, and x, right? And they flow. So if I start here, they will have some kind of, I have some kind of flow. If I start here, it will flow this way, right? If I start here, it will flow this way. If I start here, it will flow that way. Capital Y is constant along the flow. The capital letter combinations are things that are invariant under the flow. They're labeling which curve you're on. There's no reason why a system here should look like a system over here. They will be different. They won't look the same. But every system along this line looks like a rescaled version of every other one. So these are constants on the invariant flows. I realize that's not what you wanted. You wanted to be told, oh, that's the susceptibility or something, but that's what it is. And Ben Whittem invented these funny variables, y over x to the beta delta, before anybody understood anything. He said, oh, look at this. All these experiments can all be written down in this form. They're called Whittem scaling forms. What time is it now? Pardon?
10:30.
And we have until 11?
No, yes.
Yes, okay. So I think we should spend just a moment relaxing, and then I'll continue. So get up and stretch, and No, in fact, we compared the crumpling noise for the first crumple with the re-rumpling noise, and yep. Yeah, everything's good. I'm taking a break. Okay, I think we should start. Okay, so I'm going to be giving you next a bunch of examples of universal scaling functions, and they're going to, in the end, illustrate things that happen when you do these universal scaling functions. So first, you'll end up getting very familiar with this z of x and y being given by some power law times universal function. It's a little bit like translation invariance, where you have a function of x and x prime only depending on x minus x prime, except there's a power law in front. And it's ratios, not differences. Okay, so first thing is the avalanche size distribution. You saw the Gutenberg-Richter law. These are the avalanche sizes that you measure in the random fieldizing model in three dimensions. And you can see it's a log-log plot. And all of you know that straight lines and a log-log plot give you power laws. That dashed line is the power law for the avalanche size distribution, which is usually called S to the minus tau, except I'm not not plotting the probability, I'm plotting the fraction of the volume contained in avalanches of size S, so it's 1 minus tau, and I'm integrating over the avalanche size, over the field, so it's 1 minus tau bar. Okay? And that blue line is the correct answer, and these are simulations farther and farther away from the critical point, which is at little r equals 0. All right? Some things I want to point out. One thing is that each of these power laws stops after a while. So here, you're getting close, as you coarse grain, you get closer and closer to the fixed point, and then here, you've now veered off because you know you're not quite at the fixed point, and you flow away. And that typically gives you this kind of exponential cutoff. Second thing I should point out is that as you get closer and closer to the critical point, you get closer and closer to the true answer, but it took a long time to get there. That these last systems to get at this 0.04 critical point without hitting the system size, we had to go to systems of a billion spins. Billion spins, not a big deal. At the time, you couldn't fit them in memory. We had to write code that couldn't store the random fields. It had to generate them on the fly in a very sneaky way, and it used 1 bit per spin, and then we could get it this big. And you notice that one of the problems is that at early smaller systems, it sure looked like it was a different power law. It wasn't the tau bar that we got from the scaling collapse I'll show you in a moment. So there were discrepancies. There's a power law that you see, and there's a power law that the theory would predict, and they were different. And I'll explain why. So there's a wrong power law, which is given by this dashed line, which does a spectacular job over 2 decades in size even more decades in probability, and it's the wrong power law. It's just wrong. The last thing I wanted to point out is that these dotted gray lines, if you can barely see them down here, those are the predictions of the universal scaling function. So if you have the universal scaling function, you don't have to worry about fitting power laws to these. You just fit the whole universal scaling function, and it does a wonderful job all the way out to r equals 0.46, which is way away from the critical point. So far, so good? Here's the universal scaling collapse. Now, you remember that the true avalanche size distribution is given by S to the 1 minus tau bar times curly A. You can flip that around. You can take S to the tau bar minus 1 times the avalanche sizes that we saw before and plot them against S to the sigma R. Right? And when you do that, all the data should collapse under one curve. This is called a scaling collapse. It's a standard tool. Those of you who have used it a lot are looking at me like, why are you talking about this? But many of you haven't seen this. And this is what told us that our power law was wrong. That we, to get a collapse, we had to do it this way. And you will see that this black curve sure looks like it's going to hit 0 until you got a billion spin simulations and could show that it was bending off. In fact, I should have put the black curve underneath so you could see there's a blue curve just coming right down there. Okay? So this is a very weird universal scaling function. It grows by a factor of 10 and then falls down. And it could have, it's allowed to actually go to zero here. That would be what's sometimes called a singular scaling function. The word singular is thrown around in this literature in ways that I do not understand, but it says that the exponent you measure may not be the exponent you get. Okay? And if your scaling function is not boring, if it does something singular, then at that singularity, your naive renormalization group exponents won't describe the behavior. You have to also understand the singularity in the scaling function. That will come up again at least twice. All right. How am I doing on time? I have until 11? Oh, okay. So I should have let you rest a little longer. Oh yes, I should at least do this and maybe I'll start into mean field theories. So, Ken Wilson and Michael Fisher and a giant number of people immediately afterward, all these guys had studied Feynman diagrams and things like that, and Ken Wilson solved all this with Feynman diagrams so everyone could jump in and play in the game. What they did was Ken Wilson found a perturbation theory about four dimensions. This is called the epsilon expansion. And it's voodoo, but it works. And he was able to extrapolate down to three dimensions and do a pretty good job of capturing the Ising model critical exponents. In a FISREV letter called The Ising Model in 3.99 Dimensions, it was cool. And this now phase diagram you end up with, above four dimensions, the problem is the universal properties really do have, you know, quadratic maxima, just as you would write with a simple theory. In fact, there's a whole class of things called mean field theories, which now aren't all simple. For the Ising model, the mean field theory is simple. For spin glasses and the random field Ising model and things like that, you have functional renormalization groups and very complicated epsilon expansions and real field theory, which I won't describe here. And you can use this perturbation in epsilon to get critical properties in three dimensions with irrational critical exponents. Then down in two dimensions, it's called the lower critical dimension. This is the upper critical dimension. And below the lower critical dimension, you can't have long-range order. And in fact, there's a theorem, if you have a continuous symmetry breaking by Hohenberg, Merman, and Wagner, that you can't even have long-range order in two dimensions, although you can have a critical point, it turns out. And one of the interesting things about this diagram, when I apply it to the jamming transition, which I will Thursday and Friday, is that the upper critical dimension is 2, and the lower critical dimension is 2. It's a little weird, okay? And because the upper critical dimension is 2, you can do mean field theory. So one of the themes that I have to explain is mean field theory. So I need to tell you a little bit about mean field theory. I skipped a slide here. There we go. Mean field theories. There are many kinds of mean field theories. I'm going to describe in a moment, or maybe on Thursday, depending upon how much time I have, the Curie-Weiss law. The Curie-Weiss law says you have an Ising model, it's got a spin, it's got neighbors. Let's pretend all the neighbors have the average spin, and then you figure out the magnetization of this spin, and you make them equal to one another, and that gives you a phase transition. And that corresponds very precisely to an infinite range model, where every spin is connected to every other spin equally, which I like to think of as a hypertetrahedron. Here are all the bonds. There are n spins, there are n points, all connected to one another. There's also a beta lattice version, where you can keep the coordination, you know, 3 or 4 or something like that, but have a branching tree that with no loops. You can have you can go to infinite dimensions. Every spin has so many neighbors in infinite, it has 2 times the dimension number of neighbors on a hypercubic lattice. There are so many neighbors, it's really exploring the average behavior of everybody else. And many of the models with disorder, the infinite dimensional limit is accessible by very clever people. I believe our next speaker is one of them. Yes?
Yeah, Francesco, yeah.
And then there are a whole bunch of other theories that are mean field-like. And we're going to be using the coherent potential approximation or vector medium theory. I can't keep track of which one is which and why one is different from the other. But I'm relying on my experts around me to keep me straight on that. All of these will give the correct critical behavior above the upper critical dimension. The upper critical dimension could be higher. So for the random field Ising model, the upper critical dimension is pretty much known to be 6, although it's hard to do simulations in 7 dimensions. We did very small ones in the olden days. We actually did it in 9 dimensions. We can make it lower. Jamming is upper critical dimension is 2, as I mentioned. If I have long-range elastic interactions or magnetic field, long-range magnetic fields in a magnet, that can lower the upper critical dimension. And so there are bunches of real physical systems where the upper critical dimension is 3. And you can really pretty much do mean field theory and get all the right answers. Now, the mean field theory gives you an answer that you can write down on a piece of paper, maybe a lot of pieces of paper if you're doing replica theory. Why bother with a universal scaling function? I'm going to spend a lot of time. Steven spent a huge amount of time taking his solution, which he could write down on only half a sheet of paper. Half a sheet of paper, I think. And massaging it into a universal scaling form. The universal scaling form was beautiful and simpler, but that's not the main point. The main point is, first of all, it has a universal scaling form, which is already pretty mysterious. So mean field theories, you write it down, you end up with a function z of x and y having this nice form, plus higher order terms that go to 0 as you get close to the critical point. That's not at all obvious. I mean, Ken Wilson explained why it happened if you have a renormalization group, but you know we don't really have renormalization groups above the upper critical dimension. We don't have a renormalization group for jamming. Poor Sean Ridout, we spent a good half year of his life trying various schemes to do coarse graining, and none of them worked. The other thing is that the universal scaling functions, mean field theories will make predictions for everything. It just solves an approximate version of the problem. Most of those predictions, some of them are very nice. The Curie-Weiss law, the Curie law at high temperatures is very true for everything. But they will connect things that it knows very well with a bunch of predictions that aren't right. They can't be trusted. You don't know how good they are. But the universal scaling parts above the upper critical dimension will be perfect. All right? And so it's a way of sorting out from your mean field theory the pieces that are reliable, the pieces that are true. And so I'm going to claim that extracting universal predictions is an important task even after you've solved the problem with mean field theory. Yeah? Yep.
And as I go way above the critical exponent, those decay.
If you have a mean field theory, then the mean field theory in very high dimensions won't have this form, but will be correct farther and farther away from the critical point. But the higher order terms. We will talk about the higher order terms. We will talk about the higher order terms. That's one of the pairs of slides, corrections to scaling. The corrections to scaling can also be universal, and we will talk about that. Okay. 8 more minutes. Okay, I think I can do this in 8 minutes. Easily. Okay, so now there are going to be 4 steps in extracting a universal scaling prediction out of mean field theory. And I'm going through this in kind of a very bludgeony way, because in the last lecture, these 4 steps are going to consume most of the lecture, and you'll get lost in the middle if you don't remember that there are 4 steps. First step, you derive the mean field theory. You do some kind of calculation self-consistently. So in the Curie-Weiss law, if you have Z neighbors, then the spin in the middle that I'm going to assume an average field for has an external field H, and has Z neighbors, each of which are pulling on it with a strength M, or J times M, but J is 1, okay? So this is the Boltzmann factor favoring being parallel to your average neighbors and the external field. This is the Boltzmann factor being unhappy that it's in the wrong direction. These are the 2 Boltzmann factors that add together to get the partition function, which you all know about, and makes this a probability. And then the probability of it being up has to agree with the magnetization that I assumed. So this self-consistent formula defines the Curie-Weiss law. And you can say, well, why do I go any further? And of course, the Curie-Weiss law isn't in the universal scaling form. It's not M of T and H equal to a power law of H over T to the beta delta. Step 0. Change to little t is capital TC minus t. You change to measure things in the distance from the critical point, where here the critical point is at z. And you might say, well, how do I know what the critical point is? And I said, I'm cheating. I'm going to assume I know the answer. I'm just going to check that it's right. All right? So the third step is to substitute for m, m naught t to the beta. For h, h naught, h naught t to the beta delta times capital H. I'm sorry. For m, I'm going to take t to the beta times a universal scaling m, right? And then I multiply by m naught. For h, I'm going to take t to the beta delta times the universal scaling h and multiply by h naught. And for every time I see beta in this final formula, which is now in terms of t to the beta delta, capital H and curly M, I'm going to stick in a half, and delta, I'm going to stick in 3. Because I've done the calculation before, and I know what the exponents are. Then you get a formula. And you say, Mathematica, take its series expansion. Okay, it's still a formula, M is some function of M. And I take the series expansion, and I fiddle with it, and I reduce it, and things like that, and I discover that the lowest order term in t, little t, meaning closest to the critical point, gives me a formula for curly M. M is H minus itself cubed over 3. That is the implicit definition of the universal scaling function, curly M is a function of capital H. You remember that if I know curly M as a function of H, and I know little m of H and T is T to the beta curly M of H over T to the beta delta, then I've solved the problem. Everyone good? We're going to do the same steps and find the universal properties at the jamming transition that allow us to predict everything. No guarantees we're right, but it's an example of a possible success. And I don't know any reason why it must fail, so I'm very optimistic. Apart from the fact that these problems are notoriously hard. But okay, that's it for today. Any questions? Thank you.
Okay, we have half an hour for coffee break now, and it's just over there. We will be back at 11:30.